Hi guys, it's Jin from Mago Fanon, and today we're going to be talking about the Mouth of Sauron.
My master, Sauron the Great, bids thee welcome.
The sequence of the Mouth of Sauron is one of my favorite sequences in the film. If you didn't read the book or see the extended edition of The Lord of the Rings, be sure to do so immediately because it's an intriguing yet creepy sequence that tells us a little bit more about both the Dark Lord Sauron and his servants. In today's video, we'll first talk about this character's shady lineage and the role that he plays in the whole War of the Rings issue. Afterwards, I'll go over some of the elements that make his brief appearance in the film so unforgettable. As you can see, the Mouth of Sauron is this super creepy and evil guy. Tolkien describes him as this tall guy with an evil shape mounted upon a huge and hideous animal that may or may not have been a horse. The face of whatever he was riding was like a skull, and a flame burned in the sockets of its eyes and nostrils. As for the rider himself, Tolkien describes the rider as a man robed all in black, and everything about him was just very dark. When the Mouth of Sauron introduces himself, he introduces himself as a black Numenorean. Let's talk about that for a moment. What we're told in the literature is that before being corrupted to the side of evil, the Mouth of Sauron was one of the black Numenoreans. The fact that he's a Numenorean means that he is a man of great stature, because Numenoreans are a powerful and important race of men whose lineage go back all the way to the first age of Middle-earth. In general, Numenoreans were blessed with longer lives, wisdom, they were generally better warriors thanks to their great height. Unlike the good Numenoreans, like Elendil and his sons Anarion and Isildur, or Aragorn, a descendant of Isildur, who worshipped the good, black Numenoreans, like the Mouth of Sauron, were seduced and corrupted by Sauron and therefore worshipped Sauron, the bad. Also, unlike the good Numenoreans who used their strength and wisdom for good, black Numenoreans had an unwavering lust for power and knowledge. So when Sauron jumped in and offered them all of this and more, they were easily seduced. Other black Numenoreans include a few of the Ringwraiths who, just like the Mouth of Sauron, were enslaved to Sauron's will. When we meet the Mouth of Sauron in The Return of the King, he had already fallen into darkness and serving as a servant of Sauron. He acted as the lieutenant of the Black Tower, also known as Barad-dûr, which is the chief fortress of Sauron and Mordor. What we're told about the Mouth of Sauron was that he learned sorcery and black magic during his time working under Sauron. Sauron also entrusted him with the details of his project to screw everybody over in Middle-earth and get rid of all the good. The Mouth of Sauron is reported to have risen to the ranks because he was crueler than orcs.
Know that he suffered greatly at the hands of his host.
He was also so embroiled in dark matters that, just like Sméagol, he had forgotten his original name, so the only name we have for him is the Mouth of Sauron. Also, as his name entails, he acted as Sauron's spokesperson at the end of the Third Age, and when we meet him on screen, he's doing just that.
Is there any in this world with authority to treat with me?
We do not come to treat with Sauron. Faithless.
His appearance is very brief in the film. When we meet him, he's acting as an ambassador of sorts. He's trying to convince Aragorn and Gandalf to give up and let Saruman win the battle for Middle-earth. He tried to intimidate the army into surrounding by showing them Frodo's mithril vest so as to have them believe that Frodo had been captured.
I have a token I was bidden to show thee.
Remember that at that point, even if our heroes had crushed it at the Battle of Pelennor Fields, the only way for them to truly defeat Sauron was if Frodo destroyed the ring, because as long as the ring still existed, preserved, well kept, alive, or however you want to see it, the ring is what kept Sauron's spirit alive. And God forbid, if Sauron got a hold of his old ring again, it would have been game over for our heroes. Now, although Gandalf and Aragorn didn't know for sure if the Mouth of Sauron was telling them the truth about Frodo being caught, Gandalf turned down his proposal, so the Mouth of Sauron said, "Very well." He opened the gates and unleashed all of the armies of Barad-dûr upon our hero. In the film version, things play out differently. Aragorn decapitates him in the film version.
This concludes negotiations.
in human history, it was considered a crime to execute messengers. And in the book, the Mouth actually specifically points this out, that as an ambassador, he is protected by the laws of war, and Gandalf acknowledges this. But to me, it's a story, and whether the Mouth lives or dies, the result is the same at the end. Aragorn and his company were now 6,000 against Sauron's 60,000 orcs. It wasn't good. But Aragorn and Gandalf knew that they didn't come to battle to negotiate or even to win. Instead, they showed up and battled in order to distract Sauron's attention from Frodo and Sam, who were carrying the One Ring through Mordor to be destroyed in the fires of Mount Doom. The strategy behind that was to make Sauron think that Aragorn had the ring and was now trying to use it to overthrow Sauron. Obviously, Aragorn did not have the ring, and even if he did, it would have not helped because the ring was crafted by the Dark Lord Sauron, and although it can give those who bear it some power, at the end of the day, the ring only enters to Sauron and only he can benefit from it. So the strategy was working. Sauron emptied Mordor and Frodo and Sam could safely destroy the ring. In other words, things were going just as planned and there was pretty much no more use for the Mouth of Sauron. We don't actually know what happens to the Mouth of Sauron after this battle, but it's not recorded anywhere, but it's probable that he died in battle. Now, one of the elements that I love so much about The Lord of the Rings was that although Sauron is the primary antagonist throughout the film, Jackson does not show Sauron physically in the film. Instead, Sauron's primary appearance in Jackson's trilogy is as the Eye of Sauron on top of Barad-dûr. We also see Sauron in the prologue of The Fellowship of the Ring when he's leading the armies in one of the Wars of the Last Alliance. Originally, Sauron was also intended to appear at the Battle of the Black Gates to fight Aragorn. This was ultimately scrapped from the books due to the fact that, first of all, it's nowhere in the film, and second of all, it would take the main focus away from both Frodo and Sam in the previous strategy that was to empty Sauron's army to give Frodo time and safe passage.
For Frodo.
Now, this makes sense. Since Sauron did not physically have the ring during the Third Age, he can't take a physical form, so most of his bidding is achieved through his various servants, such as the Nazgûl, or Saruman, and of course, the Mouth of Sauron. I also think that no matter how they tried to play it, it would have been very difficult to pull off the depiction of a character as evil as Sauron on screen. What we're told in the book, and we can kind of see it in the film when Aragorn and Pippin communicate to Sauron via the Palantir, is that Sauron's mere presence causes a lot of psychological pain. I know that when the idea of including Sauron in the Battle of the Black Gates to duel Aragorn, like when that was on the table, rather than showing a cruel or evil guy, Jackson's game plan was to depict Sauron as the angelic being, or the Maia, if you prefer, that he was before he was corrupted by Morgoth, a really bad guy. Before that, when Sauron is leading his armies during the War of the Last Alliance, he's clad in black armor, so we don't actually see him. Afterwards, we only see him as the Eye, and as far as I'm concerned, that's perfect. I think it would have been very difficult to pull this off and to make it credible, and the Mouth of Sauron was the next best thing. The evil mouth, it's a home run, and it is a perfect example of how sometimes less is more. There's something about the Mouth of Sauron that's just extremely chilling. The giant rotten teeth, the cracked and exposed flesh around the lips, the fact that the hood and his helmet cover his eyes, and that deep, scary voice, and also that really creepy and brilliant health tilt. It makes this character both memorizing and loathsome. Putting this scene into the extended cut was the perfect way to personify Sauron and his evilness without actually putting Sauron on screen. The makeup artist in the digital effects team did a great job with this one. To pull this off, at first it was just amazing makeup and of course some prosthetics for the cracks and exposed flesh around the lips. Once it was filmed, it did not look scary enough, so what they did, they experimented with the footage by turning it vertically for it to be like a vertical mouth, but that didn't look right. And so what they did at the end was that they just enlarged the footage of the actor's mouth by about 100 or 200%. And that did the trick.
My master, Sauron the Great, gives thee welcome.
So that's it for today. I hope I didn't creep you out so much with this character that I find so cool, fascinating, and creepy. Let me know your thoughts in the comments, and if you wish, like this video and subscribe to my channel. It really does help. Farewell.